gather here in this place of comfort to study your word together as your children. Lord, we pray that we'll put the things of this world out of our mind as we open your word to study it and to gather knowledge of your word. And we pray, Lord, that we'll take these things and we'll study them further to apply it to our lives, that we might grow in wisdom. And Lord, we pray that we won't bottle these things up for ourselves, but we'll find every opportunity to teach others so that others too can know you and take the opportunity to obey you. Lord, we pray for any that are unable to be with us this morning, whatever that reason may be, that you'll watch over them and care for them, that they can be back with us at the next appointed time. We know, Lord, that some are sick or suffering in some way, and we pray that you will heal them as you do, and pray that you'll care for them, and that we can reach out in any way that we are able to. Lord, we thank you for all the many blessings that you give us in this life, and we pray that we'll never neglect to thank you for what you do for us, because we know that we don't deserve anything. Lord, we thank you especially for your son Jesus. We thank you for the life that he lived on this earth to give us an example, but especially for his sacrifice that gives us that hope of heaven. And it's in his name that we pray. All right. We have come to the conclusion that we ended in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 21, and we are ready to begin in verse 22. The theme of Hebrews, as we've been going through here, is the word, anybody remember? If we could sum it up in one word, better, right? The word better. The New Testament or the New Covenant is better than the Old Covenant. Christ's law is better than the old law. The new perfect law of liberty is better than the old law. And we've seen that in every way as this writer has gone through. Now, I personally believe that this writer is Paul. There's no way of really proving that. There's evidences that show that this writer's theme or way of writing is very similar to Paul. But the writer does not put his name to it, so we can't prove it. The writer in every way has shown that the new law is better than the old law, as we've gone through here so far. And we see that theme holding true here in chapter 10 as we've gone through it. In verse 20, we see by a new and living way, which we have consecrated for us through a veil, that is to say, his flesh. And verse 21, and having a high priest over the house of God. And again, who is he writing to? He's writing to Jewish Christians, those that were practicing under this old law and were converted to Christianity. And here in verse 21, he's talking about a high priest over the house of God. And so he's, again, talking about this old way, converting to this new way, and so it's better. So let's begin in verse 22, and we'll read a few verses here, and we'll talk about it. So verse 22, we'll go through 30, and then we'll discuss. So let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our hope without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as ye see the day approaching. For if we sin willfully after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sins, but a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation, which shall devour the adversaries. He that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. Of how much sore punishment, suppose ye, shall he be thought worthy, who hath trodden under foot the Son of God, and hath counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing, and hath done despite unto the Spirit of grace. For we know him that hath said, vengeance belongeth unto me, I will recompense, saith the Lord, and again the Lord shall judge his people. So verse 22 says to draw near unto him, draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith. So we need to draw near with a true heart. Let's look over at 1 Peter 2, verses 1 and 2. I'm going to go get my Bible because these notes don't go that far. Somebody who gets there, go ahead and read that for us, please. 1 Peter 2, verses 1 and 2.
Therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking, as newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the word, that you may grow thereby.
Thank you. So a true heart is going to come from where? How do we get a true heart? Or a pure heart? Pure, true heart.
Reading the Word.
Studying. And being able to have it, reading and studying with an open mind and accepting it. Anybody can just read the Word, right? But that doesn't mean they accept it.
Also, if you read the Word, you talk about a pure heart. If you get to when you don't read it for a while, it seems like the world gets to you more. Mm-hmm. If you read the Word, it makes you feel closer. Right on that one track, I think.
Right. And that's why the Word is part of, we go to Galatians chapter 6. It's part of the shield, or part of the armor of God. We use it in that whole armor. And we put on the whole armor of God. We have to study in order to have that true heart. And you're absolutely right. If we neglect study, then we allow the world to come in. Verse 23, he says, hold fast the profession of faith. One thing I like here and I think about is when the Israelites were rebuilding the wall and there were some gaps. I could be wrong with this, but there were some that he told them to fill the gap. And I may be just thinking of part of the battles, but there were some that needed to fill the gap. And when I also think of war, if there's a gap in the line, those soldiers have to hold fast that line. Because if there's any wavering or weakness in the line, then that's weakness in the whole area, and the whole line will fall. There's a documentary, I believe it's on Netflix, but there's a documentary about the, in World War II, the soldiers that were trying to break through to get to Rome when they landed in Italy. And I want to say it's the Maginot Line. I can't remember which line they were trying to get through, but the Germans were extremely tough to fight trying to get to Rome. And this one group of soldiers were fighting for months and months and months, and this line was holding with the Germans. and they fought and they fought and they fought, and we lost a lot of troops trying to break through the Rome. And we would advance and we'd advance, and then we'd fall back a little bit. We'd advance and we'd fall back. And they finally made it through and made it to Rome. I think of us as Christian soldiers when it says to hold fast the profession, because if we give up our faith, if we give up that profession of hope and waver, then we give up on God, because He is faithful, that promise. He has not given up any of His promises. The thing that made the Israelites different than the Gentiles around them is hope. It wasn't empty hope. It was hope based on the promises that He fulfilled all throughout. They had a true hope. I remember when I was in college, one of the history professors I had, he was talking about all the different world religions, and he asked the question, what made the Israelites different than all the other religions? And I gave the answer, they had a true hope because of all the promises. And he stopped and he looked at me and he said, I've never heard it put that way. And he was from New York, he was this fast speaker, and I never heard him slow down like that. He just paused. And he was like, wow, that's a good answer. And he just kept on going. But that's what made them different, is their hope was not empty. And we think about the word hope in a denominational sense. Most people say, I hope for this, I hope for that. But what do they truly mean when they say hope? When we as Christians hope for something, it shouldn't be an empty hope, because God has made promises and He is faithful to keep His promises.
Yeah, you were talking about the line breaking down. It's the same with us. If you have one member, if you have people start breaking down, it weakens the whole thing. So.
Right, yeah. When we get to verse 25, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together. Verse 23, that's 23, 24, and 25. All of those go together. Verse 24, consider one another to provoke unto love and good works. That's why we assemble. We provoke each other or encourage each other unto love and good works. We can't do that if we're not assembling together, if we're not meeting on a regular basis, if we're not encouraging each other on a regular basis. And when one member is forsaking the assembly, in other words, like we talked about, I'm pretty sure we talked about this last week, now that I think about it, when one member just outright chooses not to be here on purpose, that discourages everybody else, because now there's a gap in the line, and somebody has to fill that gap.
And then we go, this has happened before, and try to go talk to them, and it's worked.
Being a small congregation like this, we know that there's situations where people are sick and can't make it. But when somebody forsakes the assembly, you think about a bridge and the supports. If a support falls and you have to try to add something else to that, it makes it harder for that bridge to stand. And so, as a congregation, when people are having to fill so many roles, it puts a lot of stress on individuals. It discourages when people have to fill those gaps. opposite of what we should be doing. So, yeah, verse 23 through 20, even 26 all go together, but as far as the positive side of it, 23 through 25, we need each other in order to stay together. Now, verse 26, I think, is where it separates to the individual, if we think about it in a little bit different way. For if we sin willfully, after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sins. One way we can consider this as all together is if we, and I think it's Ephesians 6 that has the armor of God, now that I think about it. If we consider this as all together, then we go to Galatians 6, and this is where we bear one another's burdens. Because if this isn't where we're like busybodies, but it talks about, let's just go there, Galatians chapter 6, because I'll get this wrong. Now that I'm correcting myself, Ephesians 6 is the armor of God. Galatians 6 is talking about if a brother is at fault, verse 1, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. Now, it doesn't mean that we're guilty of somebody else's sins, but it's talking about helping each other. If someone is overtaken in a sin, we help them. Why? Because if that sin is allowed to continue, then we might be overtaken in that sin as well. And so we go to them and we help them. But again, it's not about being a busybody. What happened with Achan in the camp after he was hiding things from the spoils of war? What did God do to Achan? Allowed the earth to open up and took all of them away. And it was because of his sin, and that sin, if it had allowed to remain in the camp, could have destroyed all of Israel. And God did this several times. Why was Jericho destroyed? Why was all of these other places destroyed? It was because if this sin was allowed to remain, it could have destroyed God's people. God is a just God. He doesn't cause bad things to happen just because. He always has a reason. And that's one thing that, and I've mentioned this before, but the debate that I've brought up before between Brad Arab and Jim Miller, the college atheist that comes up during the question and answer session, he says, so how can you stand for a God, and this is a direct quote, but how can you stand for a God that allows the killing of innocent women and children? And, well, he did it for a reason. It wasn't just senseless killing. And he said, okay, so you just believe in a God that allows the killing of women and children. Okay. And then he just walks off. But, yeah, and it wasn't his debate, and so he wasn't going to allow him to really answer that question, and that wasn't what it was all about. But, yes, our God is a just God. Our God is a loving God, but our God is also a vengeful God, and justice, and what did we read there in verse 30? Vengeance belongeth unto me, which is God.
This one said, if God is a God of love, I don't believe he would do that, and I can't help but I can worship a God that does that. And so we've got to
balance it out. He's not just a God of love. If he was just a God of love, then the scales would not be balanced.
I compare him to our fathers, our parents.
Right.
They love their children, but if they go too far, they're about to be punished for their own good.
Right. And we look at our society today. If, and this kind of goes back to the hippie movement of the 60s. And if we have too much of one thing, then what happens to our society? It gets destroyed. And we see that. And or if we go the other way, if we have too much punishment and not enough love. So there has to be a balance on both sides.
We always want to put it on the side. Give them the option. So that is what we're going
to do. Just like we do our kids, the Lord does us. You know before you do it whether you should be doing it or not.
Yeah.
And you make that choice.
Like a rabbit on the ground, get broke one in.
Yeah. There's actually a verse here in Hebrews, and I want to say it's 12, verse 13. No, I'm wrong on that. But there's a verse here in Hebrews that, and I don't have it quoted because I can't remember where it's at, but God chasteneth those who he loves. And we may have already passed it, but if he didn't love us, he wouldn't punish us.
And what amazes me is even people, this person that I'm trying to help with was in a different religion, became an atheist, but now is coming. I'm helping somebody talk to this person, but it amazes me when they say, they're right, I'm wrong. They're not going to, if they say they're an atheist, where does this come from?
Right.
You know, and so I use that, and I don't want to say.
That was the thing that Brad Harrop brought up, too. It may have been that same college student, but he said, your parents have morals and ethics, right? And he said, yeah. And he said, where'd they get them from? And he said, well, their parents. And he said, well, where'd they get them from? And he said, well, their parents. And he said, right, where'd they get them from? And so he just kept going with this, and he said, my point is, we get our ethics from somewhere. They had to have come from somewhere. And obviously, they were passed on, and we got them from God. We got them from a creator.
That goes back to the first couple, where did they get it from?
Right. Exactly. And he was trying to get him to that point, and he wasn't logically thinking about it. But yeah, we get our morals and ethics passed on from our parents, grandparents, so on and so forth, and they had to have come from somewhere from the beginning.
And even though I said, don't believe, have those. And I said,
right.
Where'd you get that? I don't know how to. Yeah.
So, yes, verse 26 shows us that if we are not coming together, if we are not taking care of each other, then we are sinning willfully. So this is showing choosing not to be present together.
I don't know, on we sin willfully, like reject the church once you know, and then you reject it. There's no longer sacrifice for sins. I mean, I have another grace that leaves. Said, well, you
could
reject the church.
You know,
right.
You find yourself out of the spiritual blessing.
Then it's a far worse on you than it was before, because you know better.
Right. Now, we can come back as long as we're alive. We can repent. There is hope to come back. But this takes a conscious effort. So we're not talking about people who are not able to think for themselves. Obviously, we're not talking about little children who don't know right from wrong.
There's some people that have mental, true mental ones that can't think.
Right. We're talking about people who have obeyed the gospel, who can think for themselves, and have made the choice to reject God, who have chosen to reject the church, and have left, and are choosing not to return.
Like that one says, what is this?
It
makes Jesus' sacrifice of nothing.
Right. I think it's 5 and verse 8, 6 or something like that. Sometimes I get the numbers reversed in my mind.
You weren't ever better, huh?
Make his sacrifice of nothing, basically.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know which one you're talking about there. We crucified him afresh.
Yes.
Yeah. Exact verse in mind, but I know which one you're talking about. And that's basically what we do, because there remaineth no more sacrifice for sin. He died once for all. And that's the whole point of, again, this book or this letter is the New Testament, the New Covenant is better. There's no need to go back, because there's the sacrifice of bulls and goats didn't do anything for us. So this is a better covenant. And then we can see all the way through 27 through 30 that old law, you could have died under two or three witnesses, but now what sore punishment if we leave God and trodden underfoot Christ, because he died once. And we count the blood of Jesus as nothing. So the gospel was bought with his blood. The blood of not just any person, but the Son of God. It was bought with a price. And we can take verse 30 several different ways. Vengeance belongeth unto me, I will recompense, saith the Lord. And again, the Lord judges his people, or shall judge his people. If we turn our back on him, he's going to judge us. But we also need to remember that vengeance is not our place. If we get angry or upset, we just need to take a deep breath and relax and remember that God is taking care of. And we should not be getting so upset with people.
That's where patience comes.
Right.
It's not always easy, because we want it now.
Yeah. We need to have patience and not get so upset with people. Just relax. Because God's got it taken care of. Okay, anything else on 22 through 30? Let's go ahead and read 31 through the end of the chapter here. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God, but call to remembrance the former days in which, after ye were illuminated, ye endured a great fight of afflictions, partly whilst you were made a gazing stock, both by reproaches and afflictions, and partly whilst you became companions of them that were so used. For ye had compassion of me in my bonds, and took joyfully the spoiling of your goods, knowing in yourselves that ye have in heaven a better and an enduring substance. Cast not away therefore your confidence, which hath great recompense of reward. For ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. For yet a little while, and he that shall come will come, and will not tarry. Now the just shall live by faith, but if any man draw back, by my soul shall have no pleasure in him. But we are not of them who draw back unto perdition, and of them that believe to the saving of the soul. So 31 kind of goes with 30. It's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. When we first obey the gospel, we should definitely fear God in awe, as respect, but also in terror. We should always have that awe of God. But as we grow and mature in knowledge and in wisdom, it should transform into love. We should always remember, though, verses 30 and 31, that if we do fall away, he is a vengeful God. He's not just a loving God, but he is a vengeful God. do turn our back on him, that he will judge us. And there is a place for those that turn their back on him.
And you can kind of understand that he's given us everything, so we can have everything forever. And if you know it and just turn your back on, that wouldn't make him angry.
Right. I mean, think about how you would feel if you have given... Well, yeah, I mean, it's hard for us to think in that respect, but if you have just given, let's say you just hand over $500 to somebody to help them out, and they don't thank you, they don't say a word to you, they just turn away and walk off, and you never see them again. That kind of hurts. You just give them a lot of money, or you give them something that's really important to you, and they never say anything to you.
And he gave his son, and right. His son suffered so much for us. I would be angry too. Yeah.
And he continues to give. He blesses us in so many ways. He causes it to rain and to shine on everybody, not just those who have obeyed. And yet, there are still that don't obey, and there's still those that have obeyed that turn their back on him. Because there's times that it gets low, and they feel like they have to turn their back. And so it does get hard. It really does. Life gets hard, and we get so down, we get so discouraged. But we have to understand that there is a better way. And that's what Hebrews reminds us of.
And when we get down like that, and probably everybody's going to just pull you down, if you start reading the Word, I think it helps. Mm-hmm. I mean, where else are you going to turn to but the Lord?
Right. Turning to the Word, turning to other faithful brethren to lean on. And, you know, I don't have the verses right here in mind, but... it tells us if we just go to people, go to brethren and talk to them about our problems, and we don't need to just do it on a regular basis, but it helps to just unload a little bit and just get that off our chest.
You see, a lot of people, they don't know what they're here for in life. This Kendra's talked about that with her job. She's met a lot of people, and she said, and I want to tell them, what you're missing is the Lord. Mm-hmm. That's what you're missing. They're just wandering around with no idea about what they're doing. It never happened.
Yeah, and with jobs like the medical field and certain jobs in the government, that's where it's really difficult, because you're bound by a particular oath where you can't say certain things, and it gets extremely stressful. You have to talk to somebody. And so you have to find somebody you can trust that you know is not going to repeat what you say. Or you have to find a way to talk about it without violating
that
you have given.
That's what mommies and daddies are doing.
Yeah. Because you know they're not going to say anything.
Right.
Yeah. And so, you know, I was able to find those avenues when I worked in the medical field. Even as a teacher, I have the same oath. I can't say certain things, but I have found ways of talking about it and relieving the stress. And, you know, we in certain jobs, we have to do that. So, but as Christians, we have to find a way to relieve our stress in ethical ways, because God needs us, and we can't just get down and turn our back on Him. He needs us to fill that gap. We have to hold the line, because like we said before, if one of us gets weak, all of us get weak. We need each other to hold that line. Verse 32, goes back to what we were talking about before. He says, but call to remembrance the former days in which after you were illuminated, you endured a great flight of affliction. So these that he's writing to have obeyed the gospel, but they've been persecuted. They have felt that suffering. They've been illuminated. In other words, they have seen the light of the gospel, and then they get that great flight of affliction. They have been persecuted. They were made a gazing stock. Here we might think of all Christians, but you can definitely look at this as elders, preachers. You get that glass house feel. Everybody turns their eyes on you. Because once you put yourself out there as a Christian, now people are looking at you and, oh, well, you did this. You say you don't do this kind of stuff. We mess up. We make mistakes.
Harder on you.
Yeah.
You're a Christian.
Yeah.
Than they are themselves, because it's okay if they're not.
Yeah. That's one of those things where Jesus says, if you're going to build, count the cost. And it's not just about the work that's involved, but it's about all of that pain and affliction that's involved as well. All that persecution, the eyes that are going to be on you.
It's like when you're going someplace and you're going to be around a lot of people that aren't Christians. It's like when Elaine talked the other day. We say to ourselves, know who you are before you go there. So you can remember who you are to where they don't affect you.
And this is another thing I've mentioned before too, but like when my mom, she only did this a few times, but when she would drop me off at school, know who you represent. As a kid, I represented my parents, I represented my grandparents. As Christians, we don't just represent ourselves. We represent the church, we represent God. And like a teacher, I'm a teacher 24/7. And as Christians, we're Christians 24/7. We're not just Christians when we're in here in this building worshiping God. We are Christians when we leave this building as well. When we go out to go to work, when we go out to the grocery store, when we're driving our car and people see us at the stoplight, we are Christians all the time. People have their eyes on us.
Probably noticed when you became a Christian the difference in how people were around you. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they change. They'll change their behavior.
Even as friends.
Even if they don't change their behavior, and they want you to change yours.
I thought you said you were if you mess up. Yeah. But you lose friends. I lost friends.
Yeah.
But you know, got the Lord first. So.
That's right. We have to be willing to change a lot of things and put a lot of things behind it. One thing I wanted to point out here, this is one of those things that goes back to who is doing the writing. For ye had compassion of me in my bonds and took joyfully the spoiling of your goods, knowing in yourselves that ye have in heaven a better and an enduring substance. So for me, this kind of goes back to Paul, but again, we can't really prove that. In Acts, there's several times we see when Paul was arrested, thrown into prison, and he was very well taken care of, especially when he was in Rome and spent out the rest of his days. And he was set up. I mean, he was like set up to be taken care of while he was in Rome. And people came and they ministered him to it while he was there. And so this very well could be evidence that this was Paul. So, but again, no real proof there. taught away, therefore, your confidence. Verse 35 kind of goes back to 19, having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. We're to have boldness and confidence because of Christ and what he did for us. We should be able to go in prayer with confidence and boldness.
And if we keep that, we get Gregory more.
Right. I have a note here that the Greek word for confidence is the same word, Greek word for boldness from verse 19. So, for ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, you might receive promise. So as we've been talking, we need to have that patience, because if we endure these afflictions, if we continue to do what God has told us to do, then we're going to receive that promise. Because again, God is faithful. He has fulfilled all of these promises up to this point. And that's going to lead into the first verse of the next chapter. But he has fulfilled all of these promises up to this point. And if we maintain that patience, just like Renata just said, we're going to have a great reward. From verse 30, the end of verse 30. That's that promise, is that reward. For yet a little while, and he that shall come will come and will not tarry. Now, we don't know how long that's going to be. Obviously, we're still waiting. But Christ will come back, so there's another promise. He's faithful to keep those promises, and so we have a promise that Christ is going to come back. We just have to be patient and wait for it. Now the just shall live by faith. James chapter 2 tells us what kind of faith that is. Right. Obedient faith. It's a patient, obedient faith. But the just, those that are righteous, those that make righteous judgments. I was talking to my brother yesterday on the phone, and he started to say something about our sister, and it was about to be really mean and hateful, and he's like, no, I don't talk like that anymore. I don't talk like that. I'm not going to judge her. And I said, no, wait a minute. What you're doing is right. You shouldn't be judging her in that way, because what you were about to say was mean and hateful, and no, we don't judge that way. But just remember, it's not wrong to judge, because Jesus said to make righteous judgments. We need to judge based on making corrections about what God said. If we're not doing the right thing according to what God said, then yes, we should judge people in love. He goes, that's a good point. I'm going to write that down. And I pointed out Matthew chapter 7. And he's wanting to do this podcast thing about helping people be less stressful and things like that, but he doesn't want to bring religion into it, so he was going to study Matthew chapter 7 and spin it a different way. He's not very religious, but so I was trying to help him understand that we do have to make judgments. But him correcting himself on how he was about to judge our sister was, we don't need to. What's the rest of it?
What's the rest of it? And they look at me like, and then I tell them, and then talk to them,
yeah, nobody wants to keep going with that. All right, last verse, and then we'll close this out. We'll start with chapter 11 next week. But we are not of them who draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. So this one kind of goes back to verses 25 and 26. We're not of those that forsake or go back. He's also kind of talking about those that go back to the old law. We're not of them. We are of those that believe to the saving of the soul. So again, obedient faith. We are going to go on and continue to obey to that obedient faith to the point that our souls are going to be saved to the very end. And so it's that patience that was mentioned in verse 36. Any questions or comments before we wrap this up? Thank you guys, I appreciate it. I'll thank Earl for his notes. actually, didn't use a lot of his notes because there was a whole lot of references I didn't get to, so.